Yet another inspiring episode of Star Tales. Today we have a stellar personality who has donned on multiple hats, being from a leader to an innovator to an entrepreneur and a hardcore techie.
I take immense pleasure to welcome Pawan, CEO of Tapifany. Hello, Pawan. Welcome to Star Tales. Thank you for taking this time out and talking to us.
Hi, guys. I'm glad to be here.
Pawan, it is good to see you after so many days, and it's a virtual call, I understand. I have seen you move from the entire TCP stack, where you have dealt with connectivity, working on CRS, the flagship platform of Cisco, and also on the application side in terms of Ingreen and now Epiphany. That's quite a bit of transformation. How would you see this, Pawan? Would like to see your perception on this journey.
Sure, Rama. So I think I recently heard somebody say this, which is very true in the world right now, where it's the pace of change of technology has never been this fast, but it'll never be this slow again, right? So things are changing so fast nowadays that a few years back, we used to carry cell phones that used to look like bricks, right? Now we have these sleek little things where we can watch videos and pretty much are more powerful than most computers that were there for a few years ago. So things are changing at a rapid pace. And basically, as a person, you need to adapt. You need to understand where the technology is going, how things are changing, and be at pace with it all the time. My kids, like today, they were using PDF editors to edit their homework and send that in. So which is amazing, right? Like for a six-year-old to know how to do that without learning about it in school. So essentially, I think we all have to adapt and change to what we need to become. And like you said, I started with Cisco maybe 1998 or 1999. And then at that time, networking was a big thing, right? The IP stack was a big thing. How do you connect the world together? And once we laid that foundation, the next thing was, how do you make the wireless world connect together, right? And that's where we started working with at Vicorus, which was a startup at that time, right? And we actually helped build the first 4G network in the world. After that, I started a company called Ingreen, which was acquired by this satellite internet provider called Viasat. We actually started to deliver internet service to airplanes and remote areas over satellite, which was, again, an amazing journey. And now we recently, pre-COVID, we started another company called Epiphany, where we are trying to tackle a new challenge using some of the new innovations that have come out in the world.
Thank you, Pawan. That was fantastic in terms of the technology transformation. Now I will switch gear and now I'll talk about personality transformation. I mean, the person that I saw in Building M was a hardcore techie person sitting behind a computer, coding away to glory, which I'm sure you do it even today. But transforming to a hardcore techie to an entrepreneur and being able to flip a company to something like Viasat and now getting into Epiphany, I think that's a huge personality transformation as well. Would definitely like to get your insights.
Both the adaptation that you need to do is both from a technology as well as from a personal growth point of view, right? All throughout your life, that's what I tell my kids. You have to change. You have to change with the times, right? This, nobody could have predicted this COVID-19 would come along and change our lives so drastically, right? But people who have adapted and understood, yes, this is the new way of life, will be the ones who are succeeding. People who are trying to say, no, this will go away and it'll go back to normal, will be the ones that need to struggle through this time period, right? So. And my personal journey, I think I'm still a techie at heart. I believe that I think all the strong people I've met, like all my mentors, all the people I've worked with, strong people in my career, they have this thing that is called a T-shaped personality, right? Where people have are really deep in one area where they're experts in, and then but they have a broader set of other areas where they can actually pick up new things. And so a good example in my as in my case is I'm a hardcore software programmer. I do software for fun, right? I still write software, but I really like to essentially see how people will use my software, design it such that how would the end people would like to use my software. So I think that's a really good skill to have, where you actually build your depth in one area, but you actually have a broader view such that you just don't get stuck in one thing that you do all your life.
From a techie to an entrepreneur, what a beautiful journey, Pawan. So you successfully started a company, scaled it, and added acquired, something that most of the startups aspire to do today. Any suggestions, directions, or tips you have, you would want to give to the budding entrepreneurs from your experience?
Yeah, so I think, so being in a startup is a fun and a hard thing at the same time, right? But essentially, the thing I've learned really is that you cannot give up, right? There are so many opportunities when people will come to you and say, hey, what are you doing? There is so much rejection and negativity. Rama would know that for sure, right? Like we've gone through, like, you have to knock on so many people's doors, you're dependent on so many different things coming together to make success work, and you cannot let anything get to you, otherwise it becomes hard. You might give up and move on. But the one thing that I've learned is that this is another quote that I just read, where it says, if you love what you do, then you'll never have to work in your life, right? Because you find something that you really, really like to do, and that's it. You follow your dream along that path, right? That's what software was for me, that I really, really used to love it. Even when I was a child, I used to write software and sell it to my buddies in school, right? Their homework. But I think that's the key. Basically, you have to follow your heart, do something that you really love. Keep looking until you find that thing that you really love, right? Don't settle. And try to, when you're building a startup, another important thing to note is that if you solve a problem that you yourself have faced, that makes it super easy. Because one of the things that you learn in design thinking is that you have to walk in the shoes of your customer. If you find a problem that you can relate to yourself, then you are the customer. You're solving the problem for yourself, right? And that makes it super easy, right? Because then, yeah, you know exactly what your problem is and you know what your solution. You don't have to pretend to be somebody else, right? That's a really neat thing to think about.
That's amazing. So you mentioned about design thinking and the design first approach. Now today, design first approach is the new buzz of the industry. And I feel this is an apt question for you. You being a tech leader and inventor, what is your thought on it? And how do you think it is important or not, how it impacts in building a cutting edge tech products? How does design play an important role here?
So design plays a super important role in the world that we are in now, right? And even going further, I have seen people have stopped reading tips. They have stopped reading help documents. They have essentially, after Apple or iPhones or all of these products came out, people have stopped reading manuals, right? Nobody wants to go through to try and understand how things will be done. It should be super natural in the way you're used to doing stuff in your whole regular life. You shouldn't need somebody to teach you how. So there is this other thing that this is anthropology really, right? But essentially, if you really think about it, there are two parts of the human brain, right? There is a reptilian brain that is the core part of the brain. And then there is more of the human brain, which is the outside of the brain. But essentially what happens is if you have to use the more of the human part of the brain, you have to use more energy, right? And if you use more energy, people don't want to do that, right? They want to do things like whoever your customers are, they want to do things without using too much of their brain power So that's where design thinking is super important, right? But again, one thing to remember is that you have to build what the customer needs, not what the customer wants. Henry Ford said that, right? That if you ask people, what would you like? They'll say, I'll need a faster horse. Nobody will say, I'll need a car, because they didn't know at that time that that was a possibility, right? So again, you have, when you're doing design thinking, you have to understand what the customer or the person you're building this for would probably need, not what they're asking for.
Great. Awesome. So with all this design thing, your new tool, which is the whiteboard thing, so I see that you've given so much importance to design. You've cut the clutter and you made it so simple. Can you talk about it?
Yeah, so we made this whiteboard project, like we made this animated whiteboard thing a few weeks back, just as a side project. We understood, look, there was a real problem. We were used to being all in a room together where we would brainstorm on a whiteboard. And now since we are all working remotely, we lost that ability to brainstorm with each other. So we again started solving a problem for ourselves, right? We said, look, this is a problem we are facing on our own. And we built this tool very quickly using some of the technology from our main product, which is still a secret, right? But essentially we built this whiteboard product fairly quickly. And one of the fundamental things was that, hey, we don't want to teach people how to use a whiteboard. They already know how to use a whiteboard, right? So whatever you're making online or as a virtual whiteboard should resemble what people already know, so they don't have to learn something new, right? That was one of the fundamental design principles behind it. And once we created it, we sent it out. We haven't even started to advertise it. Now we have about 10,000 odd people using it every month. And especially like in education, people love it, right? Because remote learning is a big thing now. So we see a lot of people giving new ideas to us, people giving suggestions. So I think it's taking up a life of its own, even though we didn't intend for it.
Great. Awesome. You're one of those people that I've met where I don't see the right brain and the left brain. A lot of people believe in this myth of I'm a techie, I can't design, I'm a designer, I can't code. I think you are a perfect combination of a techie, entrepreneur, and a designer. Wonderful, Pawan. Thank you so much. That was an insightful and inspiring story. Thank you very much for taking the time out and having the small talk with us. We are sure a lot of people out there require this kind of an inspiration talk, especially in these times. Thank you once again, Pawan.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. I was happy to be here.
Thank you so much.